know, we're gonna put this in your mouth. All
right,
get her.
I can't wait to find out what she is.
I know.
It's crazy.
Place bets with all the apartment offices.
I think she looks like she has just such a pit bull face.
She's so stocky, but she almost looks like she's maybe like a golden mix.
Yeah, that dark tail retriever is like.
Oh, those are cute too. Yeah, she does look similar.
She's being so good.
Mm-hmm. You are. She's got enough. Yeah.
Okay, we're ready to start. Put those darn phones away. How's that? We only have like 45 minutes together. And we have a lot to do today. We have Harlan, whose spelling is up here on the board. H-A-R-L-Y-N. Harlan is a spayed female?
Yeah.
What was your guess? A little less than a year old?
Yeah, I said maybe 10 months.
Okay, 10 months old. So the teeth should look perfect. You know what I mean? A younger dog should have just like almost perfect teeth. And then we're going to do a DNA swab right after class. I gave her some of this kangaroo jerky, and I want to explain how I got that. Plus, I'm going to pass something else around. Before we have two presentations today, and then I've got to talk about altitude and stuff like that, but we'll get going. Yesterday, I went to the dog show at the Indy State Fairgrounds. Anybody else went there? Okay, there's a few of you. Good. Did you guys go Saturday or Sunday or Thursday or Friday? It was a long...
I showed Sunday.
Did you show Sunday?
Yeah.
What did you show?
I showed a
golden retriever. Golden retriever. Okay. Anybody else show? You were there, right? Back here in the corner? Anybody else go? Okay, maybe you're just stretching. Okay, yeah. Okay, anyway, great time. And then, here's a couple things. If you ever go to those things, those people are so friendly. It's crazy. And then all the dogs are great. So it's like, you know, a lot of things happening. And I saw this kangaroo jerky at this one place, and I thought, oh, that'd be kind of neat, because I know I have a dog coming today, and this morning. I have a dog in class this afternoon. And so I thought, well, try the kangaroo jerky. It's from Australia, obviously. And then the other thing is, I'm going to pass this brochure around. Actually, I'll pass that around too. You can look at it. Look in the back. Is it 80% protein, I think? Does it say 80? 81% protein. And here's the other thing I ran into. Somebody collecting dog semen and storing it for you. And I thought that was kind of interesting. I'll pass that around. This woman had a little booth, and I didn't want to ask like 20 questions, you know, because you might thought I was like interrogating her or something. But she had this little tent set up inside the fairgrounds in the building, and she would collect semen, evaluate it, and then extend it with an egg yolk extender, like they do cattle, and then freeze it in liquid nitrogen and store it for you. And then she would even ship it someplace for you in the United States. So I thought that was kind of very interesting. I'm going to pass that brochure around. And it's amazing the things you learn. And then, of course, there's all kinds of dogs. And I got to show you a picture of a dog. And I'm going to show you the picture. And then I'm going to say, why in the world would you do this? Lock that door again, okay? So, let me... I forgot one thing. Get this started. Okay, so I'm almost ready. And... Okay, so here we go. What kind of breed? Bernese Mountain Dog. And you can walk back where they're preparing the dogs. It's all pretty neat. Beautiful dog. Anyway, I'm gonna stop that. And then go on. Here's, you know, they're judging. Beautiful. Okay, look at this. Look how much time. That's a Maltese there, although I got a picture of the face, but I didn't show that. That's a Maltese. But I got one coming up that says, why in the world would you do this to a dog? Okay? Look at that face. Okay, and then all kinds of golden retrievers. And then the next one. Why would you do this to a dog? Sorry. Look at that. Why? I don't understand this. Why you would do that? The trimming and stuff? Poor dog's probably embarrassed to walk around. Okay. Okay, so now everybody, we need to stop chatting. I hear chatting. Okay, so here's what we're doing. We're going to have Lexi come up. Are you here? Yeah, yep. Lexi's here. This is your slide, right?
Yep.
Okay. Let me get the pointer and make sure it's working for you. So we got Lexi and Connor talking. Here, you practice on the wall there. Okay? Okay. Oh, good, a toy.
Okay, so I'm going to talk about teratogens, and then I have a few examples of different common ones that we see. So a teratogen is an agent that causes birth defects or only one defect. Basically, it's something in the environment that a mother's exposed to or she purposely exposes herself to it. 4 to 5% of birth defects are from teratogens.
Did you say 4 to 5%?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And then teratogens can affect the fetus as soon as 10 to 14 days after conception in the womb. So one of the examples is alcohol, so fetal alcohol syndrome, what we talked about in class last week. Alcohol anytime has potential to cause issues, not just only during the beginning of pregnancy or the end. It affects the central nervous system, which is something that is susceptible to teratogens throughout the whole pregnancy, so that's why alcohol is such a big issue. It can cause, it's actually the most common non-genetic cause of mental retardation in the United States, so something that's not genetic. And it can have withdrawal or dependent symptoms in the fetus after it's born. Another one is an anticonvulsant called Dilantin, something that's used for epilepsy. And 10%, there's a 10% chance of fetal hydantoin syndrome if taken in the first trimester. So women who have epilepsy have to go see their doctors and sometimes change medications or find different ways because it'll affect the fetus negatively.
Now, Lexi, I know you have another slide. Are some of these things on the other slide or not?
It was just like a list of names.
Okay.
So this one I thought was more important.
Okay.
And then another one is an ACE inhibitor, which is an angiotensin converting enzyme, which is used for high blood pressure. And it can cause fetal growth restriction, kidney failure, and death in the fetus. Another two, lithium and diazepam, so used for tranquilizers or anxiety. Those can cause congenital abnormalities, like a cleft lip or cleft palates. Another one, smoking, cigarettes. Premature birth, fetal growth restriction. It can increase a startle reflex or a tremor in the fetus. And then one of the other ones they talked about was maternal conditions, so something that the mother has had her whole life. An example I found was asthma. That can cause the fetus to have trouble receiving oxygen, premature birth, a low birth weight, and it can cause cerebral palsy too if it's not controlled enough. And then this picture I found kind of talks about when teratogens can really affect the fetus. So in the beginning it talks about right after conception, it's not super easy or not susceptible to get teratogens, but then as the fetus is developing more, there's different things that are affected easier. So the central nervous system is something that can be affected the whole entire pregnancy, whereas the eyes, teeth, et cetera, are affected later in
the
pregnancy.
So now are they more susceptible when it's light or when it's blue, or do you know what I mean? Oh, I guess just the bar, sorry. Not the color in the bar.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's all I got.
Okay, anybody have any questions? I mean, we had the reading has all those lists. I mean, it's amazing, isn't it?
Oh, there are so many to choose from.
It's mind-boggling.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Yep.
Appreciate it. Here's the other, I did put that other slide up that you had, but, you know, I'm only going to ask you about the ones that are clicked on the reading, but I thought Lexi, gave a little overview. I mean, look at even warfarin. I mean, it's amazing how things are. Okay, thalidomide, that's Connor, right, Connor? This is not your slide, but I put it in here as a space keeper for me.
Okay.
You might want to point to it or go to your slide. Look where the pointer is. Check it out. Got it? That top little green thing there? Okay. Obviously, Harlan is doing pretty good. Has Harlan been way over in that corner yet or not? Okay, look it. She's been way over the whole room. Okay, that's excellent.
All right. I was given the drug thalidomide.
Thalidomide,
which is a teratogen. And so it's was in 1957, it was marketed in West Germany under the name Conteragen by Kemi Grunenthal. It was prescribed as a sedative for sleeping better, insomnia, anxiety, and gastritis. Then, later in that year, it was they found it was to cure morning sickness in pregnant women, and it was an over-the-counter drug. Later that year, there were about 6,000 infants born with phocomelia.
And that's that next slide. Do the right arrow for you. No, on the keypad. Sorry.
Which is the misformation of limbs, and so there's only a 40% survival rate among those born in West Germany. Worldwide, there were about 10,000 cases with only a 50% survival rate. And some of the other effects, besides just deformed arms and limbs, were deformed eyes and hearts, deformed urinary tracts, and deafness and blindness. However, because of this epidemic, it led to better drug regulation and development following this epidemic. It is now sold as Immunoprin as an immunomodulatory drug which modifies and helps the immune response, and it's used to treat some cancers like multiple myeloma.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, so the take-home point there is even if a drug does this to the fetus, it might have some useful medical...
Yeah, it is useful.
Yeah.
And it was also... It was also used to help cure leprosy, too.
Okay, yeah.
Improve the effects of it.
So I think I pronounced it wrong, but yeah, I think it's thalidomide.
Thalidomide is
the actual pronunciation.
Yeah, so it had some terrible effects, but it also led to better drug regulations.
Right,
so.
Right. But yeah, okay, thanks.
You're welcome.
But obviously that's a permanent effect of a drug, but yet it's used in people that aren't pregnant, so... That's a take-home lesson. Okay, I just want to talk a little bit about, we're passing the kangaroo stuff around. DES, that stands for Diethylstilbestrol. I know there's some reading clicks for it too, and I think I got one more slide about it. But this is interesting to show you how dangerous some of these things are, because this was prescribed to prevent miscarriages or whatever. So when it was given to a pregnant woman, the woman would be called a first-generation effect. Now, follow this. This is a little complicated. So the first-generation effect is it affects the individual that it's given to, okay? Well, lo and behold, and Harlan smells the kangaroo jerky. She's looking for it. When the fetus was born, they found out, especially in women, the female fetuses that were born now, the women, were having certain kinds of cancer because of the drug their mother got. So when the offspring had an effect, that's called the second generation. Okay? But here's a kicker. So the women that were born, the second generation effect, have some certain kinds of cancer. But when those women have kids, sometimes the kids are damaged also. So that's called a third generation effect. I mean, look at how protracted that is. A pregnant woman's given a drug, DES, her offspring can be affected, but then the offspring's offspring. Got that? I mean, that is incredible. Anyway, Purdue did a lot of work with this in the animal science department, because estrogens, they tend to make a leaner carcass. So they were looking at meat quality and feeding cattle this. And it was fed to cattle for a while. And then once they found all the, kind of the bad effects, I think the FDA just banned it totally. Okay, so that's the end of that one. So yeah.
Okay.
So anyway, diethylstilbestrol. I know there's some clicks on that. Okay. So now, let's do some altitude material. We're going on, and I know Wednesday, checking out the dog. There we go. Okay. A mild, okay, anyway. Sorry, distracted. So when you go up in altitude, the air expands and it gets less dense, and the oxygen molecules are further and further apart. So when you take a breath or a cow takes a breath, they're getting less oxygen per breath. And I've got some charts that'll show this, but the amount of oxygen carried by hemoglobin starts going down as you go up in altitude, okay? And let's see, what else do I want to say about this one? Okay, you know, you get sick, you could, the reading has some of this. That was kind of introduction to altitude. Okay, so then you would call it hypoxia, right? Hypoxia is a term that means low oxygen level. If you're looking in the blood of an animal or person, you would say hypoxemia, H-Y-P-O-X-E-M-I-A, hypoxemia, low oxygen in the blood. This means low oxygen, so you can have a hypoxic environment. So one of the effects is you get an increased red blood cell count over time if an animal or a person lives at a higher altitude, and we're going to talk about that effect. Now, Harlan isn't getting into anything back there, like eating or anything?
No, I have Chex Mix in my bag.
Okay, you just have some food in your bag. That's okay. Okay, so you get red blood cell count increase, and it's due to this word erythropoietin, and we're going to talk about that. So there's erythropoietin, and that literally means production of red blood cells. And it's from an area in the kidney called the juxtaglomerular apparatus, JGA. And when you're up there in the mountains, and cattle too, by the way, you get increased heart rate. The heart works, has to work harder, and that's one of the kickers. It's called right heart failure is what happens. So how does that work? It ends up being, and this is kind of crazy, but when you're up in the higher altitude and you're getting less oxygen per breath, the blood vessels in your lungs constrict. Not totally, but you know, they get smaller. And if you remember your anatomy, it's the right heart that sends blood to the lungs, right? As blood exits the right ventricle, it goes to the pulmonary artery. Yes, because the left ventricle goes to the aorta. So you've got vasoconstriction, and now the right heart has to work harder, and over time, it gets thicker. Just like, you know, if you work out at the co-rec, your muscles will get bigger. The right heart gets bigger. But what happens is, it basically makes the right ventricle smaller, because the muscle wall gets thicker and you have less volume pump. So long story short, the heart, the right side of the heart works harder and you get right heart failure sooner or later. We'll talk about this. Okay. So here, and the rest of it, over here is where I want to look at. I want to look at oxygen saturation versus altitude. So, like here, we're at sea level and even up to maybe 3,000-4,000 feet. Your hemoglobin is 100% saturated with oxygen. Like now, if you ever go to the physician's office, they put that thing on your finger, that little probe. How many have had that? Yeah, and it's checking how much oxygen is in your blood. It sends out a little ray, a little I'm not sure if it's ultraviolet or it's some little signal it sends to your finger, and if you've got enough oxygen in your blood, it'll read that you're like 100% saturated. But look at it, as you go up in altitude, the amount of saturation goes down, and that's obviously not good because then your heart's going to start working harder. Okay, so then let's talk about the erythropoietin mechanism. If you have low oxygen in the blood, your blood circulates, and one of the organs that responds is the kidney. So the kidney responds to hypoxemia, right? And then it also says, and I've got another figure for this, the liver also makes erythropoietin a little bit. So then these two organs, especially the kidneys, both of them, will release erythropoietin. Erythropoietin is a hormone. It's protein in nature. I've got a label here or another figure. It'll show you. You can buy it. Not you can't buy it, but you can be prescribed erythropoietin, and I'll tell you a couple of reasons why. Anyway, in the normal case, when you go up, let's say, high in elevation, erythropoietin is released in the blood, circulates to the bone marrow, and the bone marrow makes more red blood cells. Okay? And when you make more red blood cells in your blood, what happens to your packed cell volume? What happens to your hematocrit? That's the same question. Increases. So at a higher altitude, you would expect somebody to have an increased packed cell volume. And that means your blood is a little thicker. Okay? So then when you get more, you're able to get more oxygen out of each breath because you have more red blood cells to, you know, tie up the oxygen. When you get back to normal blood oxygen, then this doesn't work and the erythropoietin isn't released as much by the kidney. Okay, so here's the normal kidney on the left. And if you don't recognize it, this would be like a histological section, although an artist drew it. These are parts of the nephron, right? The nephron are the urine-making part. But then you have some cells here in this, I don't know if that's brown, but they're going to make erythropoietin. And there's the acronym for erythropoietin, EPO. So you're going to get EPO. Over here, if you have a diseased kidney, you're going to get less EPO response. So somebody with kidney disease won't have as good response to altitude as somebody without kidney disease. Or what if you're missing a kidney? If you're missing a kidney, you probably don't have as much erythropoietin made, right? Anyway, so you get erythropoietin from the kidney, but you also get some from the liver, and I included this drawing because the liver is making erythropoietin. So if you ever study endocrinology, somebody might say, okay, the kidney makes erythropoietin. You got to understand that sometimes other organs make erythropoietin. And then I've got like a little sidebar, and I want to talk a little bit about ectopic hormone production. That's ECTOPIC, ectopic hormone production. And what if you came into a seminar and said, I'm going to spend this whole hour on ectopic hormone production. Somebody tell me what you're going to hear about. Anybody? Here.
Hormones being produced where they shouldn't be.
Hormones produced where they shouldn't be. Perfect. Nailed it. And I'll give you one example. I don't have a EPO example, but I have another example. So it's hormones being made by tissue that normally don't make this hormone. So you know every cell in the body has the whole complement of DNA, right? Every cell in the body can potentially make anything it wants. So here's an example. HCG, that's little H, big C, big G. This is my example of ectopic hormone production. HCG, what's that in the acronym stands for? HCG?
Oh, okay. It's like humans. something's gonadotropin.
Yeah, human chorionic gonadotropin. If you go to the drugstore, and I've done this when I taught an endocrinology lab, can you imagine? I went into a drugstore and bought a pregnancy test, a multiple ones. That's what that test looks for, HCG, because it's only made by the human placenta. Okay, there we go. That's teasing, Alyssa. But do you know some men with cancer will make HCG? And that would be the prime example of ectopic hormone production, because there's really no HCG should be found in any male because it's supposed to be placenta specific. So the kicker is, always be aware there might be other organs making a hormone. In this case, it's normal. But sometimes some hormone's going to show up and it's going to raise a red flag because it's not like appropriate for the time or the situation. Okay, so then a couple things for EPO therapy. Now I'm going to say you can buy it. I think the next picture has like a little picture of the actual drug. You can be prescribed EPO. Now in this case, it's for anemia. Now on the time is on the x-axis and blood count is on the y. They don't make a good example of this. But here's somebody with severe anemia, low blood count, and when they get a transfusion, there's a transient, short-lived increase in packed cell volume, right? And then it goes down because those red blood cells you get from somebody else have a short life, okay? They're only going to live so long. Then if you start EPO therapy, you actually get a larger sustained increase in the hematocrit or the amount of red blood cells, okay? So that's one use. If somebody has like chronic anemia, they can be injected with EPO. Another example is if you ever have elective surgery and you know you might lose some blood at the operating table, you can be injected with this material, EPO now I'm talking about, and donate blood to yourself. And you can store up 2 or 3 pints before the surgery happens. Do you have to test that blood at all for any diseases or anything at all? They probably would, just as a matter of course, but you don't. It's your own blood. So if you're on a surgery table and there's some blood loss, they just get your own pint back, maybe another one. So it's used in that case. Obviously, that's what's called elective surgery, right? Like next month I'm going to have surgery, so I'm going to bank up some red blood cells. It doesn't work with, you know, accidents or whatever. Okay, so that's EPO. Okay, so then one other thing, and I'll just point out a couple of things that we should remember. It has other functions in the body. The main one is kidney makes it, goes to the bone marrow. Where's that one? Right here. So EPO, that's what we just talked about. Erythropoiesis, making red blood cells. Let's look at this. It also helps in wound healing. So there might be cases where a physician gives a patient injections of EPO, because now it's synthetically made, and I'll show you the label, for wound healing. We already talked about a little bit wound healing. What's the other thing that helps wounds heal? Hyperbaric oxygen chambers, right? Okay, and let's do this. Then let's do another one, renal protection. It might have some other functions in the organ that makes it. Remember, EPO is coming from the kidney, but look at this. It might have some intra-organ benefits. So the point is, it's often not like one hormone does one thing at one organ. So maybe one more thing over here. It helps in angiogenesis and vascular protection. That's two different concepts. Angiogenesis, that word means making blood vessels. When you gain weight or develop something new, you have to make blood vessels. Angiogenesis. Okay, here is, and I got to enlarge this, here is the human growth hormone. And sorry, it's fuzzy, but I couldn't find a big picture of it. But you should spell out recombinant, and I'll spell it for you, and some of you can help me. Let me get it smaller. Re, R-E-C-O-M, R-E-C-O-M-B-I-N-A-N-T, recombinant human erythropoietin, and forget about the alpha, whatever. And then it's international units. What does recombinant mean?
They make it like artificially?
It's made in bacteria. They program bacteria to make erythropoietin. Because I said it was a protein hormone, right? This would be a case in human medicine. A lot of dairy farms are using recombinant hormones. What hormone are dairy farms using? Recombinant bovine growth hormone. And what do they use it for in dairy cattle? Increased milk production? Yeah. Recombinant means we've programmed some bacteria, and I actually was at a place where we're making human insulin recombinant. They have these huge vats where bacteria are living. I mean, it's like, I think I saw a vat that was equal to half this room. And they had another one, And everything's stirring and bacteria like, you know, a certain temperature. And I asked them what the electric bill was because everything was running by electricity. The place I was at that was making insulin, the electric bill for the month was $1 million. Okay? So recombinant, human erythropoietin. Okay, so now, one thing, and yeah, I'm still doing altitude now. Here's one thing that happens, pulmonary edema for people and animals. And I love this little graph because here's the normal alveolus. We already talked about this like in the beginning of the semester. They're air sacs. But one of the problems is you get fluid in the alveolus, and they're labeling that pulmonary edema. So that happens when they climb Mount Everest. They got to be careful of that. It also happens in our livestock. I'm going to shut this off for 1 second. Okay, so pulmonary edema happens. I'm not going to read this whole thing. I just wanted to say that because here's that word, vaso. Yeah. So I'll explain it. Remember how the blood vessels get smaller, right? And the heart's pumping hard. What happens is fluid leaks out of capillaries in the lungs and it goes into the alveolus, like I showed you.
Don't forget the DNA test.
Oh yeah, that's right. Thanks. I'm giving the dog a treat, but we're gonna be swabbing the cheek, so after we do it. Sorry. Okay. Thanks, Megan. Okay, yeah. See, you guys are helpers. Anyway, vasoconstriction. Fluid is being pushed out, drives the fluid out of the pulmonary capillaries. And some of that fluid goes in. Sorry. I've got to apologize. Yeah, okay. Okay, so then in cattle, you get high mountain disease. Bovine high mountain disease at altitudes. And somebody, of course, Colorado. Nobody in Indiana talks about this, right? Because we don't have any high mountains. Colorado would be an issue. It affects not only lung function, but also obviously reproduction. And animals actually die of this, will die of this. Okay, so here is, what's the breed here?
Hereford.
Looks like a polled Hereford, doesn't it? Polled. Polled means born without horns. You guys know that term? P-O-L-L-E-D. That's a polled Hereford probably. We're looking at the left side, a left lateral view. This is the brisket, okay? And the brisket is like right where my pointer is, there's the heart back in there. and the lungs would be up here, but the heart is like probably right behind there. That's a normal brisket. When cattle go up to the elevations, this swells because of the fluid leaking out of the capillaries. Not only will you get fluid in the alveoli, you'll get them in the other tissue. So, and it took me a while to find the cow looking the same way. Now the next picture I have is the cow's looking the same way, but it's not the same cow, okay? But this is normal, right? That's as big as about it gets. And then another thing is, notice how cranial to the mammary gland, it's kind of tucked up here, right? That's normal, okay? Now I'm going to show you brisket disease. Try to keep that picture in mind, and then we're going to do the next one. Can you see that this brisket's a lot bigger? Probably two or three times normal. So there's normal, there's abnormal. Yeah?
So is the bovine high mountain disease the same as brisket disease?
Yeah, brisket disease equals bovine high mountain disease. Yep, if I didn't make that point. Yep. And then even in front of the mammary gland, see this? There's even some edema there, although it's not the same cow, but definitely there it is. Okay, so then brisket disease, high mountain disease, you get the accumulation of fluid, and here's another cow, but she's pointing the other way, but she's got a bad case of edema there, okay? So now, when you're out west, you can do a test to see if cattle are susceptible to brisket disease or high mountain disease. And it's called pulmonary arterial pressure, PAP. Can you imagine what you find if you Google PAP tests? Yeah. So last night I'm running into all these PAP tests that are not talking about cattle. They're talking about some other wild animal. You guys know what I'm talking about. Anyway, finally, I found some stuff about the PAP test, but it's called pulmonary arterial pressure. And what they do is they take the pulmonary pressure of these cattle that have been living up in the mountains. I think, and I'll probably show you that Wednesday as a finish. I think they have to be up there 2 or 3 weeks, and then they measure the pressure. But then they have, and then there's different scores, okay? So obviously, if you have an animal that's, in this case, the age of the animal, if you have a young heifer, and their pressure is up here, that's bad, okay? And the thing is, what you want to do is, if it's better to do this test than have the animals will sooner or later die if they're very in the high risk category. But then there's genetic lines. They've been selecting animals, cattle, that are resistant to brisket disease, okay? And so there's some ranches out there that they advertise how all their livestock are resistant to brisket disease. And then you can take them up in the elevations because there's a lot of pasture up there in the summer, but in the winter you want to bring them down because of, you know, snow and stuff. Okay, and I think that's it. Okay, so we're going to stop right there. We're going to do the swab. So make sure Hyland doesn't leave the classroom.